HarperCollins presents Shark, written and read by Paul de Gelder. I'd like to dedicate this book to all those who work tirelessly, creating films, changing legislation, fundraising, and sharing their own love of sharks so that we might continue to have these wonderful creatures in our oceans for generations to come. Foreword. We are at war with the natural world, and in so being, we are revealing a war within ourselves. A battle of ignorance and truth, fear and understanding, corruption and morality. It may be shocking for some to learn that in the last 50 years, we have seen 2/3 of all wildlife populations eradicated from the face of the earth. And beneath the waves, 90% of all the large fish in our seas have gone. In fact, explorers and documentary filmmakers must now travel to the ends of the earth to find pockets of wildlife that still remain. Yet those Edens of life are ever shrinking under the threats of poaching and extraction. It can be easy for many of us to disregard the significance of this parabolic shift from a once abundant to a now scarce natural world. We can fool ourselves quite successfully into thinking none of this will ever touch our lives. But this naive and rather arrogant attitude is the very thing catapulting us further and further into the chaos, like the story of Icarus flying with wings made of wax and feathers ever closer to the sun. It's clear we have set our course on a trajectory that is in urgent need of re-evaluation, and one of the people with whom I have been fortunate enough to connect is Paul de Gelder, who is on a mission to correct our course. I was adamant about featuring Paul in my Netflix original film, Seaspiracy, not only because he is one of the most passionate shark conservationists on the planet, but also because of his inspiring personal story of triumph and transformation in spite of the challenges life has thrown at him. It's not every day that someone on a military counterterrorism trial is almost killed by a shark, lives to tell the tale, and ends up devoting their life to promoting the protection of the very thing that almost killed them, and swimming close up with them regularly too. Today, our psychological and digital landscapes have become saturated with narratives of fear, division, and deceit. Humanity now craves answers for how we can live in harmony with each other and the rest of the natural world. The irony, of course, is that a species who has aspirationally named themselves humane beings must now look for guidance from some of the very species we have come to fear the most. Despite the bad press that sharks have received, our young species has much to learn from creatures who have inhabited the earth before trees even existed. Who better to take us on that journey from ignorance to truth and fear to understanding than someone who looked fear in the eye and offered compassion in return? Ali Tabrizi, filmmaker. Introduction. Like billions of other people around the world, to hear the word shark once filled me with terror. And why not? Think of those huge gaping jaws filled with razor-sharp teeth. I bet that everyone reading this book has at some point worried about becoming a meal for one of these animals. Where does that fear come from? Headlines like "Man-eating sea monster stalks the coastline killing surfer" certainly don't help. As a young boy growing up in Australia, I spent a lot of time in the water, and movies like Jaws had me so scared of sharks that I'd even think about them in the swimming pools that I used to compete in. This could have been James Bond's fault, as tanks full of ravenous sharks are used by the bad guys in four, yes, four of the franchise films. Of course, some explanation for our fear of sharks lies in the power of our imagination. I loved movies like Jaws and James Bond as a kid because there were stories well told. And while not every one of us will write a blockbuster, we are all the writer and director of the movies in our minds. And many of the stories that we create for ourselves are horrors. There's probably a good reason for that. Perhaps the overactive imagination of our ancestors helped save them from ending up in a saber-toothed tiger's belly. But too often in life, we let the fear that we have created override fact and truth. Are some people attacked by sharks? Yes, and we'll talk about some of them, but the truth is that far more people drown in their own bathtubs than are attacked by sharks. So why is it that so many of us are afraid to dip our toe in the ocean, but we have no worries about getting into a hot bath with a glass of wine? Australia is a country that has a reputation for deadly and dangerous creatures. A lot of people I meet around the world tell me that they'd love to visit my home country, but they're too scared of the wildlife. Believe it or not, most Australians don't ever encounter these creatures in their entire lifetime. Zoos, aquariums, and reptile parks are very popular attractions with visitors and the locals in Australia. From behind thick glass or looking down from above, anxious spectators can get a look at massive crocodiles, deadly snakes, and venomous spiders. In aquariums, you can watch the rhythmic swimming of a grey nurse shark. They may have beady yellow eyes, but the grey nurse sharks have only ever bitten humans when provoked, and they've never killed one, so they're hardly the stuff of nightmares. As for the apex predators that sit atop of the ocean's food chains, such as tiger sharks, makos, and of course, the great whites, people have tried to contain these beautiful creatures in captivity, but every attempt has failed, and the animal has perished. These marvels of the underwater realm are wild and free, and the majority of humans will never see one in their lifetime, not in person, and definitely not as they're being eaten by one. That didn't stop me being afraid of them as a kid. I'd go spearfishing with my grandfather and boogie boarding on huge swells with my brother. I knew there were sharks out there, and I constantly thought they'd want to take a bite out of me. But some things worried me more than being eaten alive, like impressing my dad. My pride was stronger than my fear, but I didn't ever conquer my terror. I simply pushed it to one side rather than forcing myself to confront what scared me. That was my way of dealing with most things as a kid and a young adult. I was a bit of a wayward youth, but something that I always had was a love of nature and a desire to see more of the world. To put it short, I wanted an adventure. For a young bloke without any money, the only way for me to get that was by joining the military, and I enlisted with the Australian Army in November 2000. I chose the infantry as my specialty, running around with the weight of a house on your back, and then volunteered for the paratroopers, jumping out of an airplane, crash landing, then running around with the weight of a house on your back. My greatest memory of that time is of being deployed as a United Nations peacekeeper to a small nation in Southeast Asia called East Timor, also known as Timor-Leste. I was the only person in my small unit of about 30 guys to take a language course in Tetum-Tetic. And so, with an entire 2 weeks of training under my belt, I became the translator. This was one of the greatest gifts I was ever given, as I was able to experience a way of life and a people that I never would have met in my previous life as a bartender. I couldn't wait to do it again, but the army had other plans for me, and I spent the next 2 years in an incredibly frustrating cycle of training without deployments. In the end, I decided that it was time to move on. I did 4 years as a paratrooper, where I was given a lot of opportunities to confront fear. When you parachute at night, you basically jump out into an empty, black sky and hope for the best. But I didn't ever come across any opportunities to confront my fear of sharks. Not surprisingly, you don't see too many of them when you're working in the Australian bush. And so my fear of the terrors of the deep remained exactly as it had as a child. I may have grown a lot in those 4 years, but my fear of sharks was unchanged. It may surprise you, then, to learn that I asked to transfer to the Navy to become a diver. And not just any diver, but a clearance diver, which is an elite unit that works in small teams to conduct a variety of missions from salvage to demolition. As you may have guessed from the name, being a Navy clearance diver involves spending a lot of time in the water. I was always in the pool or the ocean as a kid, and after a break from it in the army, I decided that I really missed it. Plus, these guys were based in one of the nicest parts of Sydney, and I could live on Bondi Beach, which may have factored into my decision-making too. The clearance divers are a secretive and highly respected branch of the armed forces, and the selection process was exactly what you'd expect from a prestigious group. I was pushed to my limits and then further again. A lot of the training took place in Sydney Harbour, and while I was still scared of sharks, I was more scared of failure. It's no exaggeration to say that I would rather have died than give in. Sometimes you have to give yourself no other option but to succeed. After selection and training courses for a year and a half, I served for 2.5 years at Clearance Diving Team 1 in Sydney. I spent a lot of my time in the water on duty and body surfing off duty. Never in this time did I see even one of the creatures of my nightmares, but I often worried about them. What would shoot out at me from the murky depths? What was in the waves that I rode? Sharks were on my mind every time that I got into the water, but I never seemed to be on theirs. That all changed one early morning in February 2009. I was conducting a counter-terrorism trial that involved swimming solo around the warships in Sydney Harbour. Sharks were on my mind, but they'd never bothered me before, so I tried to rationalise it that they wouldn't bother me that day. I'd spent hundreds, thousands of hours in the water. Why would that day be any different? Whack! The 9-foot bull shark slammed into me and grabbed a huge chunk of my leg and hand in its jaws. I was like a chew toy to this predator, and when it started thrashing its jaws, I was overcome by the most intense pain I could have ever imagined, and I feared that I would be torn apart and dragged into the deep. My life did actually flash before my eyes, but then a strange thing happened. It let go. I was pulled out of the water, and several surgical operations later, I woke up to find that I was missing half an arm and a leg. Up until that day, I had been terrified of sharks. But only now, after one had tried to eat me alive, would they become the primary focus of my life, and more than that. I refused to let my injuries stop me from doing what I loved, and I went back into the ocean and even back into Sydney Harbour. While I was definitely still scared of sharks, what scared me more was not being able to continue to do my job in the Navy. I passed every test they put in front of me and re-qualified as a Navy clearance diver. But the bottom line became clear. The Navy would never allow me to rejoin my dive team or deploy on combat operations. For the first time in a long while, I began to have doubts as to what my future would hold. Who would have thought that it was the bull shark that would steer me down a new career path I could never have imagined? As part of my recovery, I started to read more about sharks. I wanted to understand what had changed my life, and the more I learned, the more I realized how much we as humans are changing theirs. My story was followed by the Australian media, and it wasn't long before I began to receive requests to give talks to businesses and teams about overcoming adversity, and I started to consider that this could become a new career. I became absolutely fascinated by these superheroes of our ocean and their incredible abilities. When opportunity knocked and I was given the chance to start working with sharks for TV documentaries, I jumped straight into that life and I've never looked back. I've been a presenter for Shark Week, an annual event on Discovery Channel, for some time now. And I like to joke that the producers are always trying to kill me. Well, at least I hope I'm joking. They've thrown me from airplanes into the ocean, left me drifting in the Atlantic and the Pacific Oceans for days, and had me swimming through bags of my own blood to see if it would send sharks into a frenzy. But I'm still here, and I haven't lost any more limbs since the attack in Sydney Harbour. I wish I could say the sharks are doing just as well as me, but unfortunately, you are reading this book in a time of massive crisis for these fascinating creatures. Sharks have taken hundreds of millions of years to evolve, but the human race is killing them at a rate that will see many, if not most, species become extinct in the coming decades. We have a short time to act, or sharks will be lost to the world forever. The good news is that you as an individual can make a difference. It's time to meet these denizens of the deep and find out what makes them so special, so important, and yet so endangered. Be warned, though, you may fall in love with them as much as I have. Paul de Gelder, Los Angeles. 2022. Chapter 1. The Marvel of the Sea. Shark Anatomy.
Sharks. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.